Hey, what's going on, boxing fans? This is the Rope a Dope Report. I'm your host, Chris Carlson. And this video is going to be, the topic is the HBO pay-per-view between Canelo Alvarez and Amir Khan. So it's not about that fight, but it's about the undercard. It just somewhat recently got announced and finalized. So, you know, we have Teixeira and Stevens in the opener, Mauricio Herrera and Frankie Gomez, and then David Lemieux taking on Glenn Tapia, who's stepping up in class, weight class. In class, I guess you could say, as a fighter as well. So, you know, I'm going to do a video for the Canelo-Khan fight all by itself. Not that long from now, you know. Won't be that long. So this video is really not about what I think about the catch weight or 155 or what's going to happen after the fight or why is Khan even fighting a guy at a different weight class or you know, all the different stuff. Is it going to be competitive? Is it a whitewash? Is it a showcase on pay-per-view? We're not going to get into that. We're going to talk about just the HBO pay-per-view undercard on this video. So, the opener, let's start there. I believe his name is Teixeira. I'm just going off because the Yankee player, his name was spelled like that, so that's what we're going with. Teixeira. I think he also played, where else did he play? The Rangers? Texas Rangers? I don't remember. Anyway, Teixeira's an unbeaten dude. I want to say he's from Brazil. He's an unbeaten dude. It's like 20-0 or something like that. I like this fight because it's a good step up, good test to take on Curtis Stevens, who obviously we know definitely has some power. And I think he's just a better fighter at 160 than he was at 168. Really wasn't impressed at all at his 168 fights, beyond some power, you know. But when he even started stepping up prospect to almost contender level, you could see he was very limited, and you know, he's limited to an extent anyway at 160, but definitely this weight class has been kinder to him. He's had some fun fights. Obviously, he stepped up against Golovkin and, you know, gave it a go, right? He gave a spirited effort, landed some punches in the process, made a funny face as well after getting hit, but who won? It's Triple G, right? So I like this opener. You got a Teixeira, unbeaten guy, going against a solid veteran dude at middleweight. Is Stevens in fringe contender mode? I don't know. I guess we're going to find out a little more. So I do like the fight, the opener. I think that's a very solid fight. It works for me. I really like it. It's a good test. Now, the two other fights, there's things that I like about them, and there's things where I'm kind of questioning them or not crazy about it. And here's why. So we got the second fight on the telecast will be Mauricio Herrera and Frankie Gomez. Now, obviously, we know Gomez has had problems being disciplined outside the ring. whether in trouble or you know, like for real, he blows up like crazy, misses weight. He was actually supposed to be, you know, I remember the report that said, numerous reports that said HBO was going to give him another try on the, and give him a spot on the co-feature in the Salido-Vargas fight, which I'm really excited for in StubHub. June 4th, but that's what I had heard previous. So this one kind of came out of left field. We know Mauricio Herrera was in deep talks with a variety of people, but it turned out to be Matisse that he got the deepest with, I guess you could say, in the negotiation, you know, process. So that didn't go well. Unfortunately, Matisse, his eye, it just wasn't feeling up to par. We know he injured it against Postal last fall, and something came up. Maybe it was when he was training, you know, getting ready for camp and all that, and starting to camp, and then his eye didn't feel right, and he's going to take some more time off. So hopefully Matisse is okay. But that kind of left Herrera hanging a bit, right? And so for Frankie Gomez to get this opportunity, it's not like, obviously, you know, Gomez needs a nice step-up fight. But, you know, I'm not going to sit there and say that this step is too far for him, because it may not be at all. Herrera, he may not have the most power, but he's got plenty of punching power and pop anyway, and it's timing. You know, he can set those little traps and drop some big punches on you when you're not quite ready for it. Obviously, he did that, he did that against Garcia a lot, Danny Garcia in 2014, back in the spring of 2014. So, I gotta say, it's almost like a cash out moment, although it's really not a cash out. You know, it's almost like it makes me think, they must feel pretty good about Frankie Gomez, but then again, they're not afraid to take risk with him because they gotta know what they have and how serious this guy is, if he's ever gonna be serious. So, I understand, it looked like they were gonna step him up previous anyway, so I get it from that standpoint. Time will tell if it was too high of a step at this stage in his career, not like fight wise but just activity, or should I say inactivity wise you know what I mean? So I don't know. I think it can be definitely a competitive fight. Like I said, it's a real deal fight for Frankie Gomez, but with Herrera, for Mauricio Herrera, it kind of makes me feel like I kind of want to know how many fights he has left on his Golden Boy contract. It just seems like a weird matchup considering they're both promoted by Golden Boy. I'll say that. So is Herrera on the way out of Golden Boy? Does he have a couple more fights on his deal? I don't know. It just seems weird that they're really trying to match him with established guys. I mean, they did match him with Lundy, last summer. But I don't know. I just don't. It's kind of like, really? Huh. Okay, it works. I mean, don't get me wrong. Like I said, I don't know how stylistically it will be, because Mauricio Herrera can be in fun fights, and he can also, you know, slow the pace and fight at his pace and be very effective, but maybe not as fun. I really don't know. I do think it's a good matchup, though, for Frankie Gomez. Clear step up. So I can appreciate it that way. But it's just a very unlikely matchup within where both guys are at in their career. It's a bit of a strange matchup for them two to meet right now. You'd think Herrera would be only really, unless it's for a belt, you'd think he'd be only going against guys. I mean, I don't know. I just think that he goes from Matisse and some other stuff to this, you know, to a guy that's pretty much unproven and untested, but if you look at him, you know he passes the eye test in Frankie Gomez. So I'm kind of in between. It's not that I don't like the fight. Like I said, I appreciate that it's a for real step up. So it's a good step up, big time step up for Frankie Gomez. It's just kind of weird that Golden Boy would decide to put these two together at this moment. But hopefully we get a good fight for us fight fans. And then David Lemieux and Glenn Tapia. Now, I'm torn on this one, because stylistically, you can't really argue that the potential is there for fireworks. Full-on war, bombs, like the whole nine, right? Exchanges, both of them have power. We're going to find out how much power Tapia has up at 160. So, stylistically speaking, it's got a chance to produce some serious fireworks and be a good bang for your buck. I think Stevens and Teixeira is a good bang for your buck for pay-per-view. Herrera and Frankie Gomez is a legit fight. It's just, like I said, it's a little strange that they're matching them up, but I'm okay with it. I think it's a good, you know, fight, a legit fight. But this one, this is why I have a little problems with it. Although, like I said, one on the one side, I see how much action and fun this thing could be. And that's what we're looking for as well, especially on a pay-per-view, right? So I appreciate that part of it, but for Glenn Tapia, it's been a year since he will have fought, right? And in his last fight, he got beat pretty damn good. And then you can flash back to Kirkland, and he had that success early, and then he got really took a lot of punishment. And the thing about Tapia is he's a warrior. I mean, on the way up as a prospect, dude fought with a broken jaw, and he was good to go. He was going to finish that fight, period. And, you know, maybe I have a little biasness in me off this one, because when he was a prospect, we did have him on fairly regularly on the Rope-A-Dope Radio show, on the podcast. So maybe I just have, it's not like we're cool. I couldn't call up Glenn and be like, what's up, Glenn? It's Carlito, man, from Rope-A-Dope. What's up? What's good with you? Let's go out. You know what I mean? But maybe that's something with it. I just, for your first step up at a weight class, to fight a guy that can punch, and that is basically like a top five, top six guy, I just don't know. I mean, you just, David Lemieux with Golden Boy, we know that, but Tapia is now too, and you're telling me you just signed him not too long ago, right? I think you just signed him because he just got cut from Top Rank. So signing him makes sense, but you're going to sign him to put him in with Lemieux as your first fight at 160? I don't know about that part of it. Like I said, I can't deny the action. And I just don't know, coming off a pretty damn bad beating, to an extent anyway, I'm not saying it was a whitewash the whole fight, but he took a lot of punishment in that fight. The Kirkland fight as well, but the last one as well, right? That was a year ago, and so your first fight coming back under your new promotional banner is against a guy at a new weight class that can punch and is really like a top five, top six dude. So to me, I'm a little like, man, I hope it doesn't turn into too one-sided. Like, we know we're getting Tapia as a warrior. Like I said, we know in the first handful of rounds, old boy's going to be throwing. But when he's caught with something and he's hurt bad, are we going to see kind of a repeat of him taking more punishment when maybe, promoter cap on, right? I wouldn't put him in there with David Lemieux for your first fight at 160 if I just signed the guy. Now, obviously, they're signing him for different reasons. They're not trying to really develop him at this point. But action-wise, can't deny it. Can it turn into like a mismatch halfway through and really a beating? Possibly. I really hope it doesn't, because you love to see two-way fights. But I'm a little wishy-washy on that one. I guess I have a little problem with that because, I don't know. Well, I already gave you the reasons why, right? So anyway, overall though, the co-feature doesn't, there's not a fight on here that stands out as just a, damn, dude, that could be an HBO main event. There's not that, and that's what you want in a co-feature. But the style matchup is awesome in a lot of it, and also the intrigue. Herrera Gomez does intrigue me as far as, man, that's it. That all of a sudden is a huge crossroads fight for a guy that had a lot of potential who has yet to live up to it, and Herrera, who's kind of gotten the short end of the stick. Now, the Lundy thing may have been different, but he got the short end of the stick against, you know, two guys in the last 2 years. So anyway, just kind of wrapping up the video, the Canelo undercard got finalized. Let me know what you guys think. Action-wise, you know, I think we'll get a bang for the buck. In the main event, we'll see what happens there, too. Like I said, I'll do a separate video. Anyway, leave a message. Make sure you, you know, if you're If you haven't subscribed, give me a subscribe, please, and thank you. Also, follow me on Twitter, at Ropadope Radio. And tomorrow, we'll be live, 6 on the West Coast, 9 on the East Coast, and 2 over in UK-ish time. We'll be live on Ropadope Radio. So that's blogtalkradio.com/ropadoperadio. You can call in, 646-381-4990. You can listen on your browser. You got some shopping to do? Put an earplug on and listen. Anyway, I'll be having some more videos coming out very soon. Appreciate all the support since I've been back making some vids too. Peace.